Yes, you read the title correctly. This orange cat is the best player in all of Fall Guys. The person behind this orange cat is Kawanakawafu, the best Fall Guys player of all time. With over 7,800 wins higher than any other player in the game by far. And today, I'm going to be showing you guys why this orange cat is the best player in Fall Guys. Get your notepads ready and get ready to learn. Let's begin. First, let's go over on how Neko wins in Hexagon so many times. Hexagon is a really fun mode, but if you get a bad start, that can be the difference between winning or losing. So what Neko does is once the game starts, you should look for other starting platforms to jump on. So once you do that, you have more time above everyone else, and you can see where everyone else is clumping up. And once you see that, you'll know which ways to go to avoid all of that. And that will give you a super, super good start, and that gives you time to stay up on the first layer and decide where you want to jump on the second layer, and eventually that just snowballs, and eventually you're four layers above everyone else, and it's just a super good thing to have early into your game. Now after doing that, you want to stay up for as long as possible, and one strategy to use is the diving strategy. By jumping and diving, you are adding so many more seconds to stay up on that layer, and this is something that I couldn't perfect back when I made my How Long Can Hexagon last video, but now it is a strategy used by so many good players such as Neko. The diving strategy can be used from tile to tile or for long jumps you need to make to get to other sections of hexagons, but it does take practice because sometimes you might end up hitting more than one tile at the same time, and then that just becomes a waste, so make sure you practice doing the diving strategy. But once you're super high up, the game is still going on in the layers below you. But if you want to take it a step further and just end the game quicker, what Neko does is jumps down onto the layer where the second highest player is, other than Neko, which is the first highest player, and sabotage them so that they fall down to lower layers and they have less tiles to use due to the fact that there are more players using them. Although, if you aren't that good, I would recommend just trying to stay as high as possible, unless you're trying to go for a clip like Neko does. Now that we're done with Hexagon, let's move on to the other maps, starting with Skyline Stumble. And what Neko does is goes through the map as normal, but once Neko makes it to the end, there are two paths, the pinball flippers or the treadmills, and they both have different risks. The pinball flippers are quicker, but have a higher chance of failure, and on the other hand, the treadmills are slower, but are much lower risk. But what Neko does is goes on the flippers and makes them even quicker. What you want to do is once you're on the flipper, wait until right before the flipper is about to flip up and jump. And this added momentum will send you flying up to the top. Although it is hard to time and can sometimes get you sent back to the bottom, so make sure you practice this one. Next, let's move on to Jump Showdown, and in this scenario, Jump Blowdown. Jump Showdown with a fan just adds a whole new layer of complication to the mode. You may think it's easy in the beginning, but once you get further into the finale, the fan can be a real pain to deal with. So what Neko does is in the end game, the fan is something meant to be taken seriously. So Neko jumps over the pole, but stays on the very edge of the pizza slide, opposite of the fan's rotation, so that when Neko jumps over the pole and the fan is crossing over your platform, you can just walk over to the other side of the pizza slice and not worry about the fan until the next time it comes around. Next, let's go onto one of my personal least favorite maps. Fruit Shoot used to be a very simple and easy mode, but the developers didn't like that, so they changed the fruit to be more random and more lethal at hitting players. And then they also decided to add different obstacles that get shot out and big yeetuses at the beginning to add even more complication. And most people will decide just to play the mode normally, ignoring the big yeetuses because they aren't 100% of the time going to work in your favor if you do end up messing up your jump. But it is very important to always take the big yeetuses, because otherwise everyone who did take the big yeetus is going to qualify before you and get you eliminated. When trying to jump and get hit by the big yeetus, try and jump when the big yeetus is swinging at its highest, and 99% of the time it should hit you perfectly towards the finish line. Have you ever been on tail tag and just felt helpless because of people being able to grab your tail from a mile away? Of course you have, it's Fall Guys. So in order to lower the chance of that happening, let's look at some of Neko's gameplay. When playing tail tag, usually you will get one or two people that seem to target you, either because you took their tail or for some other dumb reason, and 99% of the time when you lose, it's because someone was targeting you. And sometimes it's impossible to shake those people off, but in order to avoid that, Neko plays completely random, never sticking to doing one thing for too long. Maybe getting hit by a hammer, then jumping in between the purple platforms to running underneath the bridges. Neko's pathing is completely random, meaning that the people tailing you are going to have a much harder time trying to cut you off, so they'll just go for someone that they can chase easier. Next, let's make our way to Jump Club, and Jump Club is a very tricky and annoying map to deal with sometimes. When the Jump Only mode came out with only Jump Club and Jump Showdown as the maps, there were so many annoyances that were in the game that we didn't notice until now because of how infrequent the maps were. Some of the problems are random people griefing you, and they get themselves griefed for no reason, desync, and the annoying fruits. And although there isn't a 100% solution to these problems, what I and Neko also does is try and stay away from crowds of people, because sometimes if someone else gets hit, they can end up getting you taken out for it due to desync. Now onto DoorDash. DoorDash is a pretty simple and easy mode. Just kidding. It's an absolute nightmare trying to fit 60 people through a 6-foot wide door. I'm surprised Black Friday isn't illegal by now. But anyways, one thing that Neko does to prevent this from happening is once a door actually is broken, its pieces are still able to move around. And someone ended up figuring out that you can actually use the top of the door frame as a stool to jump over the next set of doors. And that is exactly what Neko does. Hoopsie Legends, one of the more annoying maps on this list in my opinion, which is why it's very important to do the best you possibly can when playing on this map. What Neko does is once the game starts, you should be looking for where you are spawning. Once you see your fall guy, next look at what hoops are around you. And once you know those two things, you can plan a route to get to a hoop faster than anyone else. And Neko does this perfectly, sees the golden hoop, goes for it, misses, but you get the point. Next, let's talk about tilt. And for those of you who don't know what tilt means, tilt basically means rage. Now, when playing Fall Guys, it is very easy to get tilted, especially when playing a team game or getting eliminated by desync or some other stupid reason. But Neko is basically untiltable. You can't name one time that Neko rages in any stream. Being untiltable is honestly a superpower, and if you don't tilt, nothing is stopping you from going into the next game and getting a win. Next, let's move on to Hit Parade, and Hit Parade is one of those maps that's just meh. It goes by really quickly, you either win or lose, but if you're close to losing, here's what you should do that I learned by watching Neko. Once you make it to the end poles and you're behind, try and go through the direct middle, giving you the most chance to get hit by a pole and hit forwards towards the finish line. Although you should be careful because you don't want to get hit backwards. But if you aren't in need of qualifying super badly and just want to finish, we can use this same exact logic and just go up the side of the slime where you have the least chance of getting hit by the poles. Next is how to get past these lasers in short circuit. First, you have to add, just kidding, these things are impossible. Last but not least, Thin Ice. Thin Ice is a fun mode similar to Hexagon, and if done properly, this mode can go on for hours. But one thing that I learned from watching Neko is that no, not just hours, Thin Ice can go on for days. When jumping on an almost broken tile, if you time the jump just right, it won't register that you landed on the tile, and it will stay there until you jump on it again. So, if you want to save tiles, try and jump right as you land, but if your tile does end up shaking, still jump on it one more time, because from the time the tile starts shaking, if you jump immediately, you will have time to land and jump again to the next tile, saving you so much more time and possibly getting you the sweet, sweet victory. Thanks for watching and subscribe.